Hello, nothing working today. All right, so let's look into the most difficult to defend against attacks, which is physical device access. So there's a term called the evil mate attack, which means that you leave your device, for example, in your hotel room and go outside for a few minutes, and then the maid coming to clean your room is actually basically a spy and connects some device to your mobile and extracts all the data. And so the basic rule of thumb is once the attacker really has physical access, then you've kind of lost, except if you have that kind of device encryption we talked about earlier. So you really need a very strong crypto system with many thousands of bits of key length, and that it will just take too long for the attacker to decrypt the data on your device by brute force. But that, of course, leads to another problem, because you can't remember in your head thousands of bits of key length. And there are two ways to defend or to deal with that. So the one way is to derive the key from a shorter key, which you basically know, so a passphrase or a PIN, for example. And the second alternative is to store the key somewhere where it's not easily accessible. And you can, of course, also combine these two. First way is to have this kind of key derivation function. So I've tried to illustrate this here. Key derivation function means you have, first of all, you have the PIN number by the user. That's not just known by you, PIN number or password or whatever. Then you have the so-called salt value, which is randomly chosen when you create a new PIN. Those are combined, and then they are run through this key derivation function. And this is done several thousand times, maybe. There's a specific random number. This number is known. This is public. And from the result of that, you get the key. So I don't know how many of you already had a crypto class. Does anybody know why this salt value is necessary, even if it's known? So this salt value is basically can basically be read out from the device, just the PIN isn't known. So why is still this salt value? Yeah? Yeah, exactly. So this would, if you don't have the salt value, then you can do what's called a dictionary attack. So you just run this for all possible pins one time. Maybe this will take a long time and require a lot of storage. But afterwards, then you can just look up the right the key, basically, and conclude what the PIN is when you have this big table. But if you throw in this random salt value, even if the attacker knows it, then you can't do that, because then you would have to create this kind of table not only for each PIN, but also for each salt value. And if the salt value is maybe 32 bits, then you would need suddenly four billion times as many tables, and that's of course not feasible anymore. The other interesting aspect is this number of iterations. This key derivation function itself is of course not very complex. It takes maybe, 10 nanoseconds to run or something. But if you do it 10,000 times, then it will take longer. And the reason for this is, of course, that you don't want people to be able to install some kind of malicious app, malicious software on the device, which then also tries to brute force all the PIN numbers. So it should take at least maybe 100 milliseconds for this entire process, so that it doesn't allow you to try through all possible pin combinations too quickly. But there's again one problem with this. Can you think of what that is? So this loop is, for example, on iPhones, this loop or this number of iterations is calibrated to last 80 milliseconds. So if we assume now that I have access to all of the memory, even the encrypted one, what is the problem then? Can anyone think of an issue? Well, it's calibrated to take, yeah. No, I meant the flash memory, so not the RAM. But what you if you have access to all the flash memory, then nothing prevents you from putting that data maybe onto some kind of supercomputer, where it doesn't take 80 milliseconds, but maybe 8 nanoseconds, and then you can try through all of the pins and passwords that are possible a lot faster. You can even do it in parallel on many computers at the same time, and then you can still break the password. So that would still be a problem. There's one way to defend against this, and maybe you've heard of this. There was this case of some terrorist's iPhone in San Bernardino recently. And there was quite a big discussion of how Apple could help them decrypt it or why they can't help them decrypt it. And there's one important difference with that iPhone. I don't know what's happening today, really weird. Just a moment. Sorry about that. So here we are again. So if you have this key derivation function only in software, then you can't defend against this kind of offline attack where you use a really powerful computer to just try through all combinations. So for this to work, you always need some kind of hardware-based protection too. And this is what Apple uses in more recent iPhones. They actually have a hardware key which is not publicly known and which is individual to each iPhone. So what's inside the dashed box here is basically implemented in hardware, and actually maybe it's even just this part that's implemented in hardware. The key derivation function can still be in software, but you don't know this key. Only one specific iPhone has this key. So you can't even take the memory out of one iPhone and put it in another one and then decrypt it there. And if the hardware is destroyed, for example, then the key is also lost forever. So that's the basic idea here. There are still ways around that. So for example, you can actually basically use a laser to take the cover off the chip and then really read out the individual bits, but that's extremely difficult. It's possible, but it's really very difficult, and it's also not guaranteed to work. So you might just as well destroy the chip in the process, and then the data is basically lost forever. What the this so-called secure enclave does is also, if you put in too many wrong attempts, then it will delete the key, and then of course the data is also lost forever. And if I remember correctly, what they the iPhone that was being discussed in the in that terrorism case actually was an older model which did not yet have this in hardware, and so for that reason they were able to still unlock it by bypassing this erase function, so that the iPhone would erase itself after 10 wrong PIN numbers. If you can bypass that, then of course you can try all the PIN numbers you want, and at some point you will hit the right one. But for newer iPhones, that wouldn't work anymore, because you will have all of this, or at least this part in hardware, and if you get too often get a wrong PIN, then the hardware key will be erased and you will not be able to recover the data at all anymore. So that's kind of the only way to defend against this kind of hardware-based attacks, where you really read out the memory of the device, would be to put this in hardware too, and in a way that it's not really accessible anymore from the outside. Yes?
Does that mean that the PIN you enter is turned into a key which encrypts all the data on the device?
Exactly. So,
but then what happens if we connect it to the PC with the USB cable? How can we read the data?
Well, all the encryption and decryption is done on the mobile, and so the data is passed through the operating system, which does the encryption and decryption. And you might have noticed that, for example, at least more recent Android phones don't let you connect them to a PC, or it simply doesn't work if you don't unlock them first. And that's then, of course, necessary to get the key. There is one type of attack which you can still use against this. I'll mention it briefly. So there's what's known as a cold boot attack. What I've been talking about until now is regarding the flash memory. So you can read out the flash memory independently, but if it's encrypted, you still can't really decrypt it without knowing the PIN. But what you can do is, in some cases, if you have the right kind of equipment, then you can also read out the RAM of the device while it's still running. Some people have done that by putting the device in the freezer, actually, cooling it down to minus 20 degrees, and then turning it off. Then the RAM will not lose its data immediately, but it will keep it for a few minutes. And if you have the right equipment, then you can read out the data from the RAM quickly after the device has been turned off. And then you might also be able to find the key again, because it was still in the RAM, and can then use that to decrypt the flash. Of course, that's very difficult, but it's been shown to be possible. Of course, so all of this was now mostly done in software. There's still, what I already mentioned, there's still the option of doing it in hardware, kind of like that secure enclave does in more recent iPhones. What you can also do is basically have a dedicated chip for that kind of crypto functions. Interestingly, we already have that kind of chip in our phones, which is the SIM card. But it's just used for the crypto stuff talking to the base station. It's never actually used for crypto stuff on your own device, which actually would be a perfect fit, but that's not something the carriers currently allow you to do. For example, it has all the features that that allow you to protect the keys inside the SIM card, so it's very difficult to actually open up the chip, because they actually have light sensors, for example. So as soon as you get light on the chip, just if you open it up, then it will erase its data. So it's very difficult to do that kind of analysis with an electron microscope. It's of course still possible, but the difficulty goes up way faster than it pays off in most cases. So this is kind of similar again to the Apple solution, but it would be nice to actually use the hardware we already have in our devices in the form of the SIM card. Unfortunately, it's just currently not possible, or not enabled by the manufacturers. But again, that would be the kind of secure storage which basically helps you to protect against all of the attacks I just mentioned. It's just currently not available. Okay, are there further questions? Yes, please.
But does it mean that if we kind of somebody can attack or hack one part, you would be able to attack the other?
Yes, that's also something. So that's also something iPhones do in part. So they, from that one key that's created from your PIN, they actually derive different keys for different protection levels. And depending on what protection level you specify for an app, it uses different keys to actually encrypt the data. If you crack the primary, the master key or the hardware key, then you will still have access to all of your data. But internally, it already tries to separate that a little. So you could, of course, think of some implementation where you have different pins, which then unlock different parts of the device. And there are some Android phones. There's a project at Google called Android for Work, where you basically have two different Android installations on your phone, one for your private stuff and one for your work stuff. And they are, I think they should be encrypted with different keys too, so you can, they are basically completely separate from each other. Okay, other questions?